much. Thank you for coming, and thank you for that very nice reception. I want to thank Jack for the introduction. Also, I want to thank Mark for all his hard work. It seems like I get to Florida quite often for Campaign for Liberty, but Mark has something to do with it. He has good organization skills, and he has a lot of people to work with. Thank you very much for helping out. This year, I particularly wanted to make sure I made this meeting because, we had that little straw vote last week. And I wanted to make sure you knew about the results. You might not have heard about it, so I wanted to come and let you know how things came out. But someday, when this momentum continues, which it is, the crowds are getting bigger, the enthusiasm is getting louder, the country is coming our way, pretty soon we're going to get some of those big interviews on Sunday morning. Who knows? But it is great to be here. I'd like to talk about what I talk about all the time, and that's liberty. So, but I want to address it in a certain way. Generally speaking, I am sure you have been challenged, as I have been for many years, and continue to be. And that is the accusation that we who have these particular beliefs that we believe, you know, sincerely in the Constitution, they're strange ideas. They're out of the mainstream. There's something odd about them. But I'd like to talk about what's been going on in this country, because I think the oddballs have been in control of this country way too long. Now, the one issue I've talked about for a long time and motivated me even in the early years of me being involved in politics, having to do with Bretton Woods and the monetary system. But just think about it. How often now they say that this idea of commodity money and gold and the Constitution, how silly it was. The other day I read something I found rather entertaining. I was by myself and I had to laugh a little bit because the person that was writing this said that, yes, Ron Paul has interesting ideas about monetary policy, but it's pre-industrial. And I got to thinking, does he realize where this country is moving? What has happened in the last 40 years? We've been deindustrialized by this runaway paper standard. It is only honest money that really promotes the industrialized world, and money is very important in doing that. So monetary policy is key. It's key for those who believe in the entitlement system because you have to finance it. It's key for those individuals that will finance wars overseas. And therefore, it is a very, very important issue. And when you think about what has happened over the last 100 years, essentially, since we've had our Federal Reserve, we've lost, I have to keep up, I have to check every morning exactly how much we've lost against gold. It's about 98.5%, 99% of the value of the 1913 dollar we have lost. And then they want to say, this is a good system, purposely devaluing the currency. I would say after 100 years, it's time we reevaluated and we should come to the conclusion, and that is we don't need a central bank and we need to get rid of the Federal Reserve system is what we need. But when they tell you that it's a silly idea to think about gold, how could anything be sillier than taking pieces of paper and writing numbers on them and have value? You know, Sam, I think grade school kids can be taught something about money that they don't understand in Washington. It's because they want it that way. They know that it serves a special interest. They know that it serves the interests of big government. It serves the interests of big corporations, the military-industrial complex, the financiers, the bankers. They know they can make a lot of money getting hold of that money first. But they also know when they control the money and they can control the ability to inflate at will, they also can bail themselves out when necessary. And that has to come to an end. We need to do a lot more concern about our middle class. But it's pretty bad when the Congress goes and inflates and has these stimulus programs, $1 billion here, $1 billion there. Soon it's up to $1 trillion. It's a lot of money, but it's minor compared to what the Fed does. And the Fed actually believes they should be able to and be allowed to do it in secret. You know, if we don't get rid of the Fed soon, we better at least get to audit the Fed and find out exactly what they've been doing. But just think, they've been pumping around $15 trillion these last 4 years. A third of it went to the foreign banks, foreign central banks, and foreign governments. I mean, this is such an outrage. When the people hear this, they become outraged, and more people are hearing it. The truth is I am very surprised, pleasantly so, that we are this far along on delivering this message. 4 or 5 years ago, before the last campaign, I didn't know, nobody knew how many people like you were out there that had already thought about it and knew about it. And here there were thousands and thousands. I believe today there are millions and millions of people who are now aware of what's going on. So here we take a monetary system. They argue the case that printing money is real and we should do it in secret and bail out all the special interests. At the same time, they mock the notion that we should follow the Constitution. The Constitution said only gold and silver can be legal tender. You cannot emit bills of credit, which is paper money. And what do they do? How do they have to protect their system? By force. They use the force of government. And to say with the laws, the legal tender laws, say you must settle all your contracts and use the only money, which is paper money. And if you are so eager, I mean so bold, and think that you have the right, because of the Constitution, that you have the right to use gold and silver coins, even those that were minted by our government, and that still says legal tender, and the Constitution say they're legal tender, which some have done. They can be arrested and put in prison for this, charged with counterfeiting. To use American hard money is counterfeiting. The counterfeitings are over at the Federal Reserve. So it's an absolute economic fact that by duplicating units of money with nothing behind the currency, but just to duplicate paper money, there is no additional wealth put into the economy. None. All it does is dilute wealth, redistributes wealth. It is very well known in the study of monetary history that when governments do this, and they've been doing it for centuries, this is not brand new, and when they do it, it inevitably wipes out the middle class. I mean, just think in recent history, Mexico's gone through, remonetization and runaway inflation. Germany did it. Zimbabwe's done it. South American countries have done it. And it's been done so many times. And inevitably, the only way to restore confidence is always to go back with real money. And, of course, when you do, and when we will do that, the people have to believe the individuals doing it. Because if they announce tomorrow, they said, okay, looks bad, so we're going on the gold standard. Let's say we'll make the gold 1/1500th of an ounce of gold, and we will honor that. But we won't change our foreign policy, change our spending habits, we won't change our deficits. Who would believe it? Nobody would believe that. We had one example in our history where we did that, and the people had a little bit more conviction about the country and what the government said, and that was after the Civil War. They had a resumption act, took 3 years, they quit printing greenbacks, and they withdrew some, and then we didn't have a welfare state, we didn't have an empire. After 3 years, the price of gold went down dramatically from a couple hundred dollars down to $20, and it was a non-event. But today it is so different. So to to deal with the monetary issue, you have to deal with something else that is very important. That is the role of government. And then the more important thing is to have people in government, from the presidency on down, individuals that you can trust and understand and won't lie to you. Now, as bad as it is in Washington from top down, and as bad as it is that we are suffering from the consequences of decades of teaching by socialists and Keynesians and inflationists, it's really as much the people at fault as anybody, because we're not in a challenge now. We who are in an audience like this, we're sick and tired of it all. We know what has to be done, but we're still probably numerically in minority, because more than half the people in the country have become dependent on the government. And therefore, any attempt to do it will make people very angry. And we've seen this already. We've seen this happen in the states that have tried to correct things. People get quite angry. They're angry around the world. They're very upset about what's happening. And they don't quite understand it, because prices of food are going up. But they don't know that the world economic system and the monetary system is manipulated by us printing so much money. So they're reacting to prices going up, and therefore they act out. And they're capable of doing it in this country, and they've already sowed some anger around the country as well. But the people have an appetite for big government. There's still, that's what's happened. We have a large number of people. I mean, I meet them on the stages when I have debates. They don't think we have enough wars going on. They think we need more wars going on. But thank goodness we are breaking through on that. The people are with us on that. And when you get a former Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, coming home and finally getting out of that business, saying, anybody who thinks we need another war needs their head examined. And I agree. But if we allow those who find special reasons for wanting to keep our presence around the world, so many bases in so many countries, with no real effort to bring these troops home, there was an announcement today that we're working now on agreement with the Afghan government to be able to stay, because they're inviting us to stay till 2024. Sure, sure. And the odds of us leaving Iraq, what do you think the odds are of leaving Iraq? I think they're slim to none, until we're broke, unless we get somebody in office that will change the foreign policy and bring the troops home. You know, sometimes little items stand out bigger than the trillions of dollars. It's hard to comprehend the trillions and the hundreds of billions. So there's one thing that went on in Iraq that I think you can remember, and it makes them look silly. Why are they doing this? And that is, they decided after we conquered Iraq, you know, they had all those nukes and everything over there, and we had to conquer them. But we conquered them, and we started having the green zone, but we built an embassy in the green zone. And the embassy is as big as the Vatican. And just recently in the DOD budget, they put authorization and funding for 17,000 people to be employed in the embassy in Iraq. And do you think they're planning on coming home? I would say the suggestion be that if you're going to save that $1 billion, what we should do is save the billion, put half it to the deficit reduction, and put it into some program here at home that where we can help some people who have learned, unfortunately, to be so dependent on the government just to stay alive. I think that is a solution, that if we'd stop that money spending overseas, help people out of here home, and take those 17,000 jobs and make sure they're jobs here at home, not overseas. Now, the one thing a president can do without congressional authority is he shouldn't go to war without this Congress approval and have a declaration. But one thing he can do, a president can do, and I would do, is that is, I can end the wars that are undeclared and unconstitutional. The commander-in-chief is in charge of the military. He can direct the military. We can bring them home. And they say, well, you want to bring them home too fast. We don't have enough time. Well, when they want to go send them over, they get them together and they ship them off rather fast. Why can't we ship them home just as fast? Now, it's not just in the war zones of the Middle East, but it's in the perpetual occupation of countries that we don't need to be occupying, and that is South Korea and Japan and Germany and all these countries and the nearly 900 bases that we have. Close them down, bring them home, and very quickly. I mean, if we pursue this, you will organize a military someday, but you don't do that the first week. But get them home, and just think of how many people would be spending their wages here at home rather than in the German economy, in the Japanese economy. Bring that back. That could be like a stimulus. The big issue in the campaign has been the economy and jobs. And the interviews have been pretty good, and you get a chance to answer them. But, you know, if you get 30 seconds or 60 seconds, what are you going to do to turn the economy around? And you're going to answer in 30 seconds. They took 40 years to mess this up, and you're supposed to answer in 60 seconds about how to correct it. But I can list a few things in 60 seconds that would help a whole lot. Have sound money, get rid of the regulations, reduce the taxes, bring our troops home, and change our foreign policy, and lo and behold, that could be very, very helpful. And repeal the laws, but it does take a while to get a consensus and have this happen. But the most important thing you have to do to turn it around is you have to get rid of the mistakes that have been made. Pricing in the free market is crucial. Mises, way back in 1912, said socialism can't work because they don't have a free market pricing structure, and it's impossible to work. And he was right, and it failed. But Keynesianism and what we have today, we fix the prices on one half of it. We fix the prices and alter the value of the dollar and fix the interest rates. So this would be, and it causes all the distortions. Well, you can't get back to growth until you get rid of the distortions. So you have to liquidate debt, and you have to get rid of the malinvestment. And politically, that's difficult. People don't want to do that because they're frightened. When the crisis came in 2008, it was announced, well, if we don't bail out the banks, everybody's going to suffer. There'll be a depression. So what did we do? Spent trillions and trillions of dollars bailing out the people who were making all this money. And guess what? The people got the depression, and the people lost their homes. So that didn't work. We still have the debt on the books. It was just shifted from the wealthy to the poor and the middle class because it's on our books, on our monetary system, and in our treasury. So that has to change. So what we should have been doing in 2008, which has been said by many Austrian economists, is when the crisis comes and somebody's bankrupt, you have stricter regulations, not weaker regulations, and the strict regulations say, you've messed up. You go bankrupt and wipe that debt off the books. You don't go to the people. But in many ways, we've lost confidence in freedom in general, and we've had lost confidence in an understanding of how free markets work. And we've been always talked into saying, well, there's always going to be people, you know, that will need help, and therefore we have to help them or they'll fall through the cracks. Well, when you do it their way, the way the Keynesians have done it, the cracks get bigger and more people fall through them. And you say, well, you know, and we always get charged with saying, well, if you don't help those kind of people, then you don't care. You have no humanitarian concerns. But I've come to the conclusion that if we do have humanitarian concerns, which I have and I'm sure you do, the best way to take care of human needs is to have a free society and free markets and sound money. That will take care of the maximum number of people. But they're always saying and charging us with this not caring. But if you sacrifice a little bit of liberty, let's say that you do say, well, we have to help those in need. The reason I think that is wrong is because, at first, it's not morally right to steal from one group to give it to another, regardless of what their needs are. Economically, it doesn't work, and it fails. It's not constitutionally authorized. But when you help a little bit, a few people, you've sacrificed 100% of the principle. You've endorsed redistribution of wealth, and we're bound to grow. That's sort of like saying, the income tax is not so bad if it's 1%, like it started out. But 1% has endorsed the principle that the government says they own all your income and they'll allow you to keep a certain percentage according to their dictates. That's why the income tax is the worst type of tax on a free society. And I think so much of what we've done in these last quite a few decades has been undermining this principle of our personal liberty. So many have not understood exactly where our liberties come from. They think it comes from the government. That's why they own our lives. I had one member of Congress sitting beside him, and we were voting on something that was protecting the consumer or doing something. I said, why do you have to do this? You know, why do you feel compelled to vote for this? He said, well, the people are too stupid to take care of themselves. Those were the words he used, and that's the attitude they have, and they believe that. They don't recognize it, and we can't argue that there will be no problems in a free society. It's just that they would be minimized, and there would be a lot more wealth in the country, and there would be a lot more charity in the country, and we wouldn't need the government. As soon as you do the government, you just destroy the wealth, and you destroy the free market and the whole thing on the whole property rights. But what we have done, though, is we've undermined across the board this whole idea of whose life it is. It's the government assumes it's their money, the government's money, and that it's your life. The basic principle of the draft, it says that we can draft 18-year-olds to go off to war. I know there's not a draft now, but young people still have to register just to remind everybody in case we need you. We'll ship you off, you know, and the most outrageous suggestion I hear, and there's a famous liberal economist today now talking about and arguing the case that wars end depressions and recessions. That is a criminal thought, as well as it's absolutely wrong. This idea that the Second World War, it was taught to so many of us in school, oh, the Depression ended with the Second World War. Yeah, because they hauled off 16 million Americans and put them in uniform, the unemployment rates went down, but they were getting shot at and killed, you know, and the prosperity didn't come. Prosperity came well after World War II. It took 17 years to get rid of it. But this idea that when we get into trouble, if you have a war, that'll stimulate the economy. It doesn't. It just redirects the investment. There'll be war profits. Some workers and business people might make it. But if you build a bomber that goes over and gets blown up, it didn't increase our standard of living in any way whatsoever. So this is a very dangerous thought, but it's based on the fact that governments think they own us and control us. They do that with the assumption of foreign policy, that they can use our young and send them off to fight these wars of with no purpose. They do it in economics, assuming that they have to regulate you to take care of you and tax you and assume that they own you. But what about in the other sense? The other sense, that they are convinced that you can't protect yourself. But giving up liberty in order to gain protection from the government is foolhardy, and we should never have to give up any of our freedoms to provide security for ourselves. So, in a personal way, this attack has been systematic for many, many years. It's been done with this ill-advised war on drugs. Just think of what they do in the name of regulating drugs. I thought we had a pretty good test of prohibition back in the 20s, and that we had to repeal it. But right now, everybody assumes, well, we've spent over $1 trillion on the war on drugs. We haven't gotten rid of the drugs, but we've gotten rid of our liberties. People have these SWAT teams going into the wrong houses and killing people. But it's time we recognize that it's your life. Yes, if you want to do something dumb, you're allowed to do it in a free society, but you can't go and beg other people or require the government to take care of you to do dumb things. One thing that's always been hard for me to understand is our country is still pretty good in protecting religious freedom. I think there's less tolerance than there used to be because there's some phobias around on this. But basically, most Americans say, yes, you have a right of no religion or any religion, and that seems to be fine. We protect intellectual freedoms as well, pretty well. But when it comes to your own body and making your own decisions about what foods you eat and what you drink and what you smoke and what you do and your personal habits, all of a sudden, there's a bunch up there, liberals and conservatives, saying, well, the people are too dumb to protect themselves. They're always going to do harm to themselves, and we know what's best for them, and we will take care of them. So that is insidious in the culture, and there's this belief that you need some nanny state to take care of us. But once again, it isn't an argument that it's a perfect society. But the society that I don't want is when the government controls us, whether it's financial control or personal control or religious control or control by forcing us into these wars. That's what we don't need. We need to stand up and demand our freedoms. Of course, nobody will forget where they were on 9/11. That's 10 years ago. And those were difficult times, especially for those of us who were trying to explain exactly what 9/11 was all about. But immediately afterwards, there was a fair amount of legislation that came up. The first bill that came to the floor to rectify these problems that existed wasn't to address foreign policy or exactly asking questions, why do people commit suicide terrorism? Where did these people actually come? Certainly wasn't Iraq. They didn't ask that. They said, what we need to do is pass the Patriot Act. Which makes no sense. I talked to one member of Congress when we wrote on it. I says, why are you voting for this? You haven't even had a chance to read it, and it has some terrible stuff in there. He says, how can I not vote for the Patriot Act under these circumstances? How could I go home and explain it? I says, well, that's what your job is. But almost every bill in Congress has a title to it which is exactly opposite of what it does. And this is a perfect example because I think if it had been properly named, it would have been called Repeal the Fourth Amendment Act. And most likely they would have had a difficult time passing that piece of legislation. But how in the world can attacking your freedoms in initiating this attack on our privacy, search warrants, searches without search warrants, all the way down, which more or less establish what we have to go through at airports, why we are suspected terrorists without probable cause and we're treated that way, why if you're involved in the monetary issue, you might well be charged as a terrorist, and it's just the term is thrown around. And how in the world will passing the Patriot Act make us safer without an understanding of what's going on in the world? And it's an attack on our personal liberties. So it is liberty that is the cause. That is why we continue to campaign for liberty. That's why this organization is so important. It's to change people's mind and to change the political situation in Washington or locally. I am astounded at what's happened since the last campaign, the last election period, with the campaign for liberty going around the country. I meet people that ran for office. I don't think we've counted them all, the different offices they won in state legislatures around the country, even here in Florida. Some have run and won, but they're numerous. So that is where the encouragement comes from, because the ideas are alive and well. Yes, we have terrible problems. Yes, they've undermined our liberties, but we still have some left. We're still in this room. We still have the opportunity to elect different people in Washington. And right now, we have a tremendous opportunity, because the evidence is crystal clear that the views of the last century, almost at least 70 years on 80 years on foreign policy and monetary policy, the evidence is in. They have failed, and our views are now appropriate to be put in place. And we must remember that armies can't stop an idea whose time has come. And I believe our ideas, our time has come. The country is waking up due to all the evidence that we see, the political landscape is changing. They're desperately struggling for that one single candidate that will capture the all of America, can represent the status quo. But it doesn't look like they're finding one very easy, which opens up the door for us. I really believe it. But the great strides have been made at the grassroots, the Tea Party movement, and the changes going on. This is all beneficial. And there's a good reason why the Tea Party movement arose. And it isn't so much that we know who's in the Tea Party and exactly what the beliefs are. There's no one Tea Party movement. I think I remember when it really got started back in 2007, though. But there was a need, there was a necessity for a group of people to stand up and tell it the way it is and speak out against this party system that we have. We don't have a two-party system. We have a single-party system. Just think of how much doesn't change regardless of which party. Does medical care programs change with Republicans versus the Democrats? Does monetary policy change? Does entitlement system change? Does foreign policy change? No, they endorse the same ideas. They've been taught by the same people. But what's happening in the country now is this standing up and saying, yes, we can't get their attention, but we don't have the opportunity to do it in a third party. I am always annoyed by the fact that we know what one of the excuses has been for us to go overseas, which I just don't, I just think it's a real stretch of their imagination. We're overseas to spread our goodness and spread democracy at the point of a gun. So we're going over, killing a lot of people, a lot of our people getting killed, and we're spreading democracy in the world. At the same time, our democratic process, and not democracy, but our democratic process where we can elect and have different competing parties, it's virtually impossible. It's so difficult. I tried it once. I spent most of my money trying to get on ballots. And how many interviews do you think I got? How many in the debates? It doesn't happen. So this is the reason there was a need and there was a vacuum. Something had to be done. And that's when I think people finally got so incensed and they followed up with what was happening in 07. And there's been this spontaneous movement. Of course, I have to admit there have been a few that have come over to join and get some of the benefits from the Tea Party movement as well. But nevertheless, I think it's very, very healthy. But our job is to help define that movement and how many people are upset. And I think that's what Campaign Liberty has been doing and they will continue to do. Because we know and understand what liberty means. And we know that it means personal liberty. We know it means a different foreign policy. And we know it means a different monetary policy. And certainly it means a different economic policy. And we take the oath of office very seriously. But this is where the progress has been made. And at the universities, young people a lot of times represent any significant change. And if we had no young people and if the campuses were dead and totally uninterested in what we were doing, I would be very discouraged. And yet today, this is the place where we get a lot of attention. This Young Americans for Liberty organization is an outgrowth from... It's an outgrowth of the Campaign for Liberty, and Jeff Frazee has done a magnificent job, and he's literally getting hundreds and hundreds of organized individuals around on the campuses. I believe that's very significant. And the people now have access to so much more information. I struggled when I decided in the 1950s, there was a lot I am not getting and I don't fully understand. I'm looking for information and I was trying to figure out the plain truth of these things and it wasn't that easy. I certainly didn't learn it in college, but just the desire to find it motivated me to keep looking. No internet, you didn't hear it on TV, you didn't get it from your politicians, you don't get it from the professors, so where do you get it? You had to get it elsewhere, and it was in books. And I give a lot of credit back in those years to how the Foundation for Economic Education helped me, because that it was back in the day when there were so few people trying to keep it together. But that was part of a remnant. There's always a remnant in society that holds things together. And they were part of the remnant. We still don't know where and how big the remnant is, but I'll tell you what, I get to meet a few in the remnant, and it's a lot bigger than I ever dreamed it was. So there were a few of us and a few organizations, but now they have blossomed. They have blossomed, and they've actually invaded the universities, the conventional universities, the professors that are getting into the colleges that are associated with the Mises Institute and other free market organizations. This is magnificence what's happening, and this to me makes the big difference. And then again, the dissemination of information, whether it's pure political information or educational information, it comes through the internet. It's magnificent. It's a real tool. So there's reason to be very concerned. I am talking about and believe sincerely, although I do not claim to be a prognosticator and claim that I know when things would happen. I think good economic thinking tells you that printing money, your dollar loses value and a few things like that. But I think things are going to be much worse next summer. I think the dollar is in a crisis. I think that's what the price of gold is telling us. And it's pervasive. It's around the world. It's the biggest bubble ever. All other countries use dollars in their reserves. So this is not going to be one country. It's not going to be just Greece. It's not going to be just the United States. Everybody has to face up to this. And this is why people are rushing into something that they can fully trust. Even putting money in the bank doesn't help anymore because they're talking about charging you to put your money in the bank. There's a lot of paper money and money floating around, but nobody has any confidence. And this is a sign that something big is coming on. This week, we saw that the consumer price index was going up at 0.5%, which means it's going up 0.1%. It's going up twice as fast as the government tells you. And housing prices this week are continuing, the housing sales are continuing once again to go down. But interestingly enough, if you look at the prices of houses in the last 3 months, they've been creeping up. That means that all things of real value eventually will have, there will be a need for those things, and I think that is what's happening. And we have this opportunity to use all these issues because the world is changing, the attitudes are changing, the understanding is changing, and there's a lot of room to be very optimistic about our opportunities. But as bad as things are, it will not be easy. But we're much better off than I say we were 5 or 10 years ago. Many of us were concerned at that time, but the evidence wasn't in yet. But the evidence is in now, and they know that these problems are here, so we're being so much more better received because of this. But freedom is the answer. Bringing people together, I feel so emphatically positive about the benefits of liberty. And I don't shy away ever from somebody saying, yes, I don't care about people, because it's only the free society that cares about people. And that is what we have to convince people of. And the magnificent thing about a free society, it's not judgmental. Yes, on a personal basis, you can judge your own life, your life of your kids and your family, and you may be judgmental in the sense that you know what right and wrong, but it's not judgmental in the sense that we want to write laws and decide how you should spend your money and what you should eat and whether or not you can drink raw milk or not. We shouldn't do that. But I'm convinced that it brings people together. I'm convinced that this philosophy brings together those who claim they're progressives and those who consider themselves moderates and those who consider them conservatives and libertarians, because they all have bits and pieces of the freedom ideas. And there's no reason why we can't work with people on those issues that in which we agree. And this is a way that people feel less threatened and will come together. And I claim that I have worked as well with any other group in Washington as anybody, instead of being stereotyped and say I'm a right-wing conservative and I don't talk to others on the progressive side. Because you get a lot of support from progressives who are sick and tired of Obama's constant wars and his attack on civil liberties. But in a history of freedom, it's a rather young philosophy. Authoritarianism is how the world has lived most of all history. And that is people wanting to run other people's lives, having dictators and czars and kings and all these authoritarians that want to tell us what to do. But this, we did have a good start. We didn't have a perfect constitution, a lot of shortcomings there, but it was good compared to others. And it introduced us into an age where we recognize private properties and sound money and contracts and self-reliance and not a welfare state and not a world empire. So we had this test and we became the most prosperous nation in the history of the world. We're still very wealthy. But our problem is we destroyed our production. We got careless about understanding what liberty was all about. And now our prosperity is very, very fragile, because we've destroyed the foundation, and it's not going to take a whole lot to push the whole house down, because the foundation is gone. We need to restore the principles of liberty. When we became prosperous, people became infatuated with the materialism and thought, well, materialism is wonderful, it's perpetual, and all we need is a government to help redistribute it, and we forgot all about defending the principles that produce the wealth. But now we are being pushed. And if we think that we can do this by spending and deficits and printing money and not address the subject of repairing the foundation, we're kidding ourselves. We have this opportunity. We have the people now coming with us. And right now the evidence is so clear that it is failing. Government is failing around the world. The only question is, what is it going to be replaced with? Are we going to go backwards? and get dictatorial powers, or are we going to continue the process that we had a taste of and we've been allowed to be slipping away from us? Can we restore that and get the people encouraged enough to say, let's use the remaining freedoms we have to defend our liberties and promote this great country of ours once again? Thank you very much.